We are an imperfect people. We struggle, fail, and fall short, just like everyone else. We wander this world, one step at a time, moment by moment, place to place, walking the path laid out before us. We strive for righteousness, but miss the mark. We seek God, but lose our focus. We want to love deeply, but often forget how that works. We are a broken people, made whole only by the hand of God. In the end, our life is about one thing: Jesus. And although we don't pursue Him perfectly, we still pursue Him. One day at a time.
Everyone, welcome to our Venture Church online service. If you are joining us again, welcome. And if you are new, we are so thrilled that you are with us. Please worship the Lord with us.
The sound, once lost, now found, heaven came down, and grace rescued me. Hallelujah, I am free from my sin and penalty. At the cross you took my place, with your grace on top of grace. Grace on top of grace, more than I've asked for, more than I am worth, grace on top of grace. Hallelujah, I am free from my sin and penalty. At the cross you took my place, with your grace on top of grace. The sound, once lost, now found, heaven came down, and grace rescued me. How sweet the sound, once lost, now found, heaven.
Grace rescued me.
with your grace on top of grace. Hallelujah, I am free from my sin and penalty. At the cross you took my place, with your grace on top of grace. With your grace on top of grace. With your grace on top of grace.
I'm glad you chose to tune in. I'm glad you're here today. Today I want to talk about another belief that people have in our culture, one you hear all the time. I'm sure lots of people that are hearing me right now, they believe it. It's one that sounds true but isn't. Let me start off with just a little illustration. I don't know if you remember the old, it's an old movie now, but it was called Wedding Crashers. It was with Owen Wilson and Vince Vaughn. And, you know, I can't really speak about the movie, but because I've never seen it. But here's what happens to me, okay? I'll see someone I know from church, and something like this will happen. I'll say, "Hey, what's up?" And they'll say, "Oh, good to see you, but we're in a hurry. We got to go." "Hey, where are you going to?" And they'll say, "Well, we're going to a movie," right? And like, "We're going to go see Wedding Crashers for the second time because it is just hysterical." And I'm like, "Oh, well, that's pretty awesome. Well, if it's so funny, maybe I'll go check it out." And they say, "Oh, no, Pastor Eric, you wouldn't like this movie." You know, and I'm sitting there going, now wait a minute. Come on, you're going to go and see it for the second time, yet you're telling me that I can't go see this movie? I mean, is it because I'm a pastor? So today what I want to do is I want to talk to you about sinners. I want to talk to you about another thing that the world believes that sounds true but isn't. A belief about right and wrong it's prevalent in our society today. There's so many of them. You know, I thought it was time to just revisit this topic because worldview matters. Well, let me remind you of a couple of words that I've used in the past. And the first one is relativism. Okay, now, what is relativism? Well, our working definition is it's the assumption that there is no such thing as absolute truth. For example, those of you who are maybe 50 and older, right? When you grew up, everybody around you believed in absolute truth. In other words, what was true years ago is still true today. But in today's emerging generations, there's this, well, it's not there. There's not a belief in absolute truth by most people. And they'll say, "Well, truth, you know, it kind of floats, it kind of evolves. What used to be wrong, well, hey, it's a different world today. What used to be wrong may be right today, yet you don't have the corner on truth. So what's true to you may not be true to me. What's true to me may not be true to you. So there's no such thing as absolute truth." Relativism. Which leads to second very common belief, which is subjectivism. Okay, now, what is subjectivism? It's the belief that I, the subject, I have the right to determine what's right and what's wrong without submitting my judgment to any authority outside myself. In other words, you have no idea, you have no right to tell me what's right or wrong. Right? Since there's no absolute truth, don't you try to impose your truth on me. I'll determine it myself. What is true and what's not true. Because what's true to me may not be true to you. And you know, these two very common belief systems, relativism and subjectivism, they have just led to a huge shift in virtues. Huge shift in the way that people live and what they believe at their core. For example, I'll just ask you a question. What do you think is the most commonly quoted verse in the Bible? Right? Now, how many of you would have said John 3:16, right? "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life." Right? Now, if you said that 10 years ago, well, you would have been absolutely right, but not today. I read this, that the most commonly quoted Bible verse today isn't John 3:16, but instead it's, "Judge not, lest you be judged." Matthew 7:1. In other words, don't judge me. Right? Even non-Christians, they use that all the time. Don't judge me. Don't talk about how I'm living. And this verse is often used as a defense for basically doing whatever we want. It's misused in order to justify what we're doing. For example, during the lifetime of Jesus, historians tell us that there was one virtue that stood above all others, right? What do you think was the most important virtue during the life of Jesus and for centuries before. Well, according to historians, the most common, most popular virtue was that of justice, right? God is a just God. Eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth. You do something wrong, you have to pay. You commit some sort of sin, there will be a penalty. Justice. Well, today, the most common virtue in the world is not justice. In fact, according to about 85% of the cultures in the world today, what do you think the most important virtue is? Not justice, but tolerance. In 85% of the cultures today, the most important virtue is tolerance. Right now, if you're my age or older, when you think of tolerance, you think of, putting up with somebody or something. Right? Somebody or something that you don't like, you're just putting up with them. And that's how you grew up. Right? For instance, you don't like to wear a mullet? That's all right. You do like to wear a mullet? Well, I'll tolerate you. Right? I don't like mullets, but I'll tolerate you. Now, you may like cats, right? So you tolerate my cat jokes. You may tolerate me because you don't like my cat jokes, but you'll put up with it. And every now and then I'll actually say something nice about cats to make you feel better. Well, for example, I'm starting to like cats. I just can't eat a whole one by myself. So you'll tolerate my cat jokes, but you may not like them. Well, today there is a new definition for tolerance. New definition. It basically says that all beliefs, all values, all lifestyles are equal. It doesn't matter what you believe. It doesn't matter what you do. It doesn't matter how you live, as long as you don't hurt anyone. Right? You can do whatever you want, as long as you don't hurt anyone. Don't judge me. I won't judge you. There's no truth anyway. You can't tell me what's right or wrong. I'll make that determination, right? Therefore, I can do whatever I want, and let's all tolerate whatever beliefs or lifestyles that everyone has, because they're all absolutely equal. If you could capture that mindset in just a couple of verses in Scripture, I'd pick 2 Timothy 4:3-4. When Paul said to Timothy, he says, "For the time will come when men will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they'll gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear." Hey, it's your body. You can do whatever you want. It's your life. Don't let anybody tell you how to live it. Hey, maybe it's wrong, but it's not wrong to you. Hey, the bottom line is you should be happy, right? God wants you happy, so do whatever you need to do to be happy. This is the itch, 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 scratch, 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 whatever their itching ears want to hear. In verse 4, they will turn their ears away from what? They'll turn their ears away from the truth. They'll turn aside to what? They're going to turn away from the truth and turn to myths, beliefs about right and wrong that sound true. So I want to show you three true sounding beliefs about right and wrong. Okay? Now, if you're taking notes, the first one is this. It's very common. People believe that the true sounding statement, "Hey, I'm not a bad person," right? I'm not an axe murderer. And if I am bad, well, I'm not nearly as bad as a lot of people. Right? I'm not a bad person. And in order to justify my true-sounding belief that I'm not a bad person, well, I got a couple of tools that help me to do it. One is the tool of comparison. Right? Comparison. Well, I don't cuss as much as you, right? I don't cuss and say bad words like you do. I mean, I do every now and then. Maybe if I hit my thumb with a hammer, or if I get pulled over by a police officer, or if I slice the ball into the lake, but not like you. I mean, you do it all the time, and so I'm not a bad person, because when I compare myself to someone, there's someone much worse than I am. I'm not that bad of a person. I mean, look around, there's a lot of people worse than me. Another thing I can do to justify my sinful behavior is I can repackage sin. Right? I can kind of baptize the sinful words, right? Make them sound much better. For example, don't tell me it's wrong to look at pornography. I mean, I don't like that word. I like to call it adult entertainment, right? I mean, that's what adults do to entertain themselves. It's adult entertainment. You know, don't say I lied, right? It was just a white lie. It's just a fib. It's just exaggerating. Everybody does it. Oh, don't tell me I committed adultery. I mean, look, I'm a guy, right? I'm just playing around. You know, guys, we got our needs. And hey, you know, it's not that big of a deal. I'm just fooling around. Right? No premarital sex. Oh, no, it's not premarital sex. Just a little, you know, jiggy-jiggy, right? You know, everybody does it. I'm not a bad person. I'm not doing anything else that anybody else isn't doing. Or maybe the best repackaging tool that's ever been done in history. It's not the murder of an unborn baby. It's not abortion. It's a woman's reproductive right to get rid of anything, anytime, that comes out of her body. True-sounding beliefs. Right? I'm not a bad person. The second one is born out of the statement that there's no absolute truth. Okay, and since there's no absolute truth, then number two, you have no right to tell me how to live. You know, I mean, who are you to judge me? It's my life. I can do whatever I want. And besides, you're doing some bad stuff yourself there, buddy. Right? Don't you get in my business. It's none of your business how I live. Don't tell me it's wrong, because you have no right to do that. And besides, you know, even if it is wrong, I mean, God's going to forgive me anyway, right? Right? We got this deal going. God loves me. He sends me to heaven, and that's just his kind of way of doing things. I can do whatever I want. Right? It's not a big issue. Well, what I want to do is I just want to show you when you take a true-sounding belief. Okay, that true-sounding belief number one, and you add it to true-sounding belief number two, you get true-sounding conclusion number three. And I want to show you how these dangerous beliefs, they lead to a profoundly dangerous conclusion. So belief number one, I'm not a bad person, plus belief number two, you have no right to tell me how to live. Well, you put those together and it equals belief number three, I can justify doing anything I want to. Which is exactly where tons and tons of people are living today. Not a bad person. Can't tell me what to do. Therefore, I can justify doing whatever I want to do. And I can give you one of a bazillion different examples. Let's just pick a few. Oh, hey, we're dating, and I know they say you shouldn't live together before you're married, but hey, you know everybody does it now, right? You can't tell me what's right or wrong. And we're probably going to get married anyway. You know, we're really in love. And, you know, I just say it this way. We're married in our hearts, okay? So we're moving in together. I mean, it's just a piece of paper anyway. Don't tell me how to live. Or let's say after you've been married, maybe 18 years and three kids later, and you're like, well, you know, you're just not making me happy. Right? I am not happy. I promised that deal before God, you know, for better, for worse. But let's be honest, I've gotten better and you've gotten worse. You're just not making me happy. And so since God wants me happy and you're not making me happy, then I can justify doing something that otherwise would be wrong. Right? In the name of happiness. Because, hey, I'm not a bad person. Who are you to tell me what to do? I mean, I can do whatever I want to do. It's a million different things. It could be the styles, right? I mean, you look at the styles of clothing, and, you know, mom says, hey, you know, sweetheart, you should dress more modestly. But mom, this is the style. Yeah, but hey, baby, you look like a hooker. Well, I don't care if I look like a hooker. I mean, the styles are important, so I need to be in style. Right? That doesn't matter. These are the styles, mom. Or maybe music. Well, I just like the music. Oh, I'm not listening to the words. Right? Even if they are rapping about rape and murder, it's not like I'm going to go out and do it. Right? Even though if they glorify Satan or curse worse than a sailor walking on broken glass, you know, that doesn't mean that I'm going to be influenced by it. Now, I know the Bible says that I'm supposed to think on whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, etc., etc., but I'm just listening to the music that everyone else is listening to. There's nothing wrong with that. Why, I'm not a bad person. Who are you to tell me what's right or wrong? Therefore, I can do whatever I want to do. Now, for those of you who are not Christians, okay, I really have no problem with you living that way. Really don't. Because if you don't believe in God, you don't believe in heaven and hell, you don't believe that your actions, your beliefs today are going to affect your eternity, well, you might as well just go do what you want to do. Truthfully, you might as well just do what you want. The ones that I have a problem with are those of you that call yourselves Christians. You know, that actually believe that your actions and beliefs determine your eternal destination. And basically what you're saying is, well, God, I know what you say, but I'm going to do whatever the heck I want to do anyway. And there are people from all generations of so-called Christians that have that mindset. Romans 1 talks about people that exchange the truth of God for a lie. And I want to look at Romans 1:28 because, man, if there's anything true today, in today's society, these verses capture it. Romans 1:28 and following. Furthermore, since they didn't think it worthwhile to retain the knowledge of God, he gave them over to a depraved mind to do what ought not to be done. They become filled with every kind of wickedness and evil and greed and depravity. Oh, how true is that? They're full of envy, murder, strife, and deceit and malice. How true is that? They're gossips and slanderers and God-haters and insolent and arrogant and boastful. They invent ways of doing evil. How true is that? They disobey their parents. They are senseless, faithless, heartless, ruthless. Verse 32, this is where it just pierces the way people are living today. Although they know God's righteous decree, right? That's many so-called believers. Although they know God's righteous decree that those who do such things, what do they deserve? That those who do such things deserve death. Although they know, they not only continue to do these very things, but they also approve of those who practice them. Right? God, I know this is what you want. but I'm going to do what I want anyway. Let me explain it this way. So a few weeks ago, I was driving somewhere, and I turned out into Greenway. And it's five lanes, two lanes going that way, and three lanes on the going the other way, the way I was turning. So I turned in, I made a right-hand turn, and I misjudged the speed of the car that was going my direction, right? I should have let him go before I pulled out, but I just misjudged his speed. So I pulled out in front of him, which made him change lanes. And so instinctively, you know, I humbled myself, and I gave him that, you know, that universal sign for my bad. I put my head down. I raised my hand up, like, my bad. Sorry, dude. Sorry, I misjudged it. It's my bad. Right? Well, he pulled up on me and laid on his horn. And he gave me that universal sign for your bad. Right? Which is, you know, peel the banana. Yeah. He gave me the universal signal for your bad. And, you know, he's just ripping it. And I'm like, dude, you know, I gave you the my bad sign, and you're giving me the your bad? Lay off me, man. You know, I'm sorry. I made a mistake. My bad. My bad. Honk, 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 honk. And he goes by, and I look at the back of his car, and there was a Venture bumper sticker. Just kidding. No. But there were a few other Christian bumper stickers. And I'm like, you know, I thought I was bad, but you're Mr. Bad, right? And so bumper sticker boy is flipping off a pastor, giving him the bird as he's driving by. For all I know, a flip me off guy could be here or watching today. If so, I just want to say, if you are, just drop an extra $10 in the offering. We'll call it even. It's all good. So now we laugh at that, and I think it was funny. I'm sure if he knew, he would think it was funny, which would be okay, right? As long as he didn't flip the bird again, and that just wouldn't be right. But it seems rather humorous, even though it's really sad. See, the thing is, it's really, really sad that so many of us today, we claim to know Jesus as our Savior and our Lord, but by our actions, we're actually flipping off God, aren't we? Seriously. Yeah, I know what you say, God, but boom, here's what I think about your commands. Right? We know what's right and wrong, but we continue to do the wrong thing. Why? Because I'm not a bad person. Hey, who are you to tell me what's right and what's wrong? Therefore, I can justify whatever the heck I want to do. It's all good, right? Yeah, God, you're still going to take me to heaven, right? Yeah. I mean, honestly, I don't know what else to say. So we're in this really gray world. I acknowledge that. But I want to give you just two black and white truths about you that you can take to the bank all day long. The first one is this. You are a bad person. Right? And if you're new with us, hey, thank you for tuning in to Venture Church. Hope you have a great day. We are here to make you feel good about yourself. You know, seriously, so much of what is being preached today is kind of self-help. You know, you're okay, I'm okay. Let's just try harder. How about 7 steps to your best life? You know what I mean? You got to understand this. You're a bad person. I'm a bad person. We're very sinful in the eyes of God. 1 John is real clear about this. 1 John 1:8, Scripture says that if we claim to be without sin, right, I'm a bad person. If we're living a true sounding belief, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. There's a lot of people that can't see that they're lost. I mean, just because you go to church or you grew up around the church, it doesn't matter. You're still lost. Jesus came to seek and save the lost. Until you realize that, you are lost, and you're not going to realize that you need to be found. Until you acknowledge that you're a sinner, you're not going to see a need for a Savior. I'll prove just how bad you are. Okay? Ray Comfort, he's an evangelist, and he actually used this series of questions, and I took this from him. And he asked the questions that I'll ask you. He asks, how many of you have ever told a lie? Okay. All right. Now, everybody who did not raise their hands just then, liar, liar, pants on fire. Okay. So, let me ask you another question. How many of you have ever stolen something? Right? I mean, I have. And you've stolen something. It doesn't have to be from a store. Right? Anything you took from anyone without permission is stealing. Cheating is a form of stealing. How many of you have ever had a lustful thought? Now, I never had, right? I'm a pastor. I'm a man of God. I have never... Okay, I'm lying again. I have. How many of you have ever taken God's name in vain? Well, if you take all those things, and then I would ask you, what do those things actually make you? Right? If I said you've told a lie, so in God's eyes, when God looks at you, He would say you are a... Starts with L, a liar. Yes. Yeah, He'd say you were a liar. If you've stolen something, God looks at you and He says you are a thief. If you've had a lustful thought, well, Jesus said that that's like committing adultery in your heart. So according to Jesus, He looks at your lustful thought and He said you're an adulterer. You've taken God's name in vain. What does that make you? Well, that's blasphemy, so you're a blasphemer. So when we say, I'm not a bad person, right? I'm not a bad person. God would look at you and He would say, you know, actually from my perspective, you look like a lying, thieving, adulterer, blasphemer. You are a bad person. But I got a good heart. No, you don't. Scripture says your heart is deceitful above all things. Apart from God, we're nothing. Oh, but you know, I do good works, and you know, I give Santa Claus a little extra in his little jug every Christmas, and you know, when he's out there ringing that bell, and I always pitch in at church, and I do good things. No, no, no. All of your righteousness together, it is horrible in the eyes of God. This is what Scripture says, just point blank. Isaiah 64:6, all of us have become like one who is unclean. All of our unclean acts are like what? They're like filthy rags. Now, remember what the literal translation of that Hebrew phrase is? Let me just remind you. Filthy rags. It's the rags that women used during their menstrual cycle, right? And you're allowed to go, ugh, right? See, the Bible translators, they didn't want you to go, ugh, but I kind of want you to go, ugh, right? So, because that's what it is. That's what your best acts are. It's like a rag that's not clean at all. You're a bad person. So am I. Black and white truth. Number one, you're a bad person. Black and white truth. Number two, You can find forgiveness and healing through Christ. You can today. I promise. Forever you can be different through Christ. Scripture says this, 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, God is faithful and He's a just God. What will He do? He's going to forgive all our sins and He will purify us from all unrighteousness. If you go before God today, He'll cleanse you, He'll forgive you, He'll purify you from all unrighteousness. So what leads us to that true and honest confession before God? Well, 2 Corinthians 7:10, I mean, if there's any verse in the Bible that captures kind of where I am with God right now, it's this verse. 2 Corinthians 7:10, it says, Godly sorrow. It's this deep agony of God, I am profoundly sorry for what I've done to hurt you. Godly sorrow. What does it bring? It brings repentance. Repentance leads to salvation. And that leaves what? It leaves no regret. It's godly sorrow that leads to repentance, that leads to salvation, that leaves no regrets. If I'm anything right now, I'm deeply sorrowful for the ways that I'm displeasing God. You say, well, you know, there is just this one thing in my life. You know, if I told you what it was, you'd be like, oh, just that? But there is this one thing in my life. It's been wrong for too long. Well, to me, when the holy light of God, it shines on the darkness of my heart. As I get closer to God, the reality of my sin just becomes more and more clear to me. Right? There's sorrow. And what I see today from so many Christians is not sorrow. It's hey, I hope I don't get caught. Hey, you know, forgive me. I'm going to do it anyway. It's not godly sorrow. Godly sorrow leads to repentance. And what's repentance? It's I'm lost in this low sin. Re, it means to turn the other direction. And pent is the highest, right? It's like the penthouse. I turn from the lower things to the higher way from God. I'm turning away from sin. I'm not going to come back to it. And I'm turning to you, God. And He's going to heal me. He's going to cleanse me. He's going to forgive me. It's as if I'd never sinned before. It's gone. He forgets it. When I call out on the name of Jesus, I become a new creation. Behold, all the old is gone. There is new. I'm filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. I don't have to live in sin anymore. I can overcome it. Not by my own strength, but by His power. He forgives me. But it's not, hey, God, yeah, we're buddies. You know, I'm still doing what I want. Instead, it's, I'm growing closer to you, God. You are real. You are holy. You are pure. You're right. You are truth. I want to live to please you. And when I don't, there is this deep conviction of, oh, God, I am so sorry. I am sorry. And truthfully, I see a lot more people giving God the bird than I do godly sorrow that leads to repentance. And for any way that I've failed you, I am sorry. And I'm not going to hold back anymore, God. But what you hear is, there's no such thing as absolute truth. I can determine my own destiny. And man, that is the most dangerous, subtle, deceitful plan of the enemy to take you from God. There is a truth. There is a way. There is a life. His name is Jesus. And you settle for anything else, you're settling for a cheap imitation. cheap imitation of the actual truth that can set you free. Let's pray. God, may we be people who know the truth, who see the truth, who live the truth, experience the truth of your Son, Jesus, and glorify Him in all that we do. Now, as we're still praying, I want to talk to those of you who call yourselves believers, and you have been living with this consistent, unconfessed sin. You're not repenting. You just say, hey, this is just who I am. This is just the way. Well, some of you right now, man, there is something on the front of your mind. It's on the tip of your lips. I want you to confess that to God. You know, there may be several things. God, I'm deeply sorrowful. If you're not sorrowful, then I pray that His holiness convicts you and you're convicted of your sin. And it's not something you entertain. It's not something you wink at. It's something you cry about before God. Godly sorrow leads to repentance. Now today, you just say, no, I repent. I turn from it. I'm turning to you. I'm moving the other way. I'm breaking clean. This is not going to be a part of my life anymore. By the power of the Spirit, heal me. I am not going to tolerate this. I will turn from it. I turn to you. I believe you'll forgive me and that you'll heal me. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Now, as we keep praying, there's some of you here, and, you know, I just say you are what I would call a cultural Christian. All day long, you're somebody who's grown up around the church. Maybe you believe in Jesus. You may have been baptized as a kid. You may have even been a church member. But if you look at your life, there's no evidence of the fruits of the Spirit in your life. There's no evidence of the power of Christ. Your life is no different from someone who's far from God. And I would have to ask you, is there really a difference? Do you really know Christ? Is He really the King of your life? Is he just some convenient Savior that you call on? Or do you fully surrender to Him? Have you done that? Fully surrendered your life to Him? Today is your day. Right? You can't clean up your life by yourself. You'll never be saved by your good works. It's only by the grace of God. It's only by the power of God. And when you are saved, when you're changed, it will lead to good works, and you'll be different because Jesus has touched you. Just pray something like this in your heart. Heavenly Father, save me from my sins. Jesus, be the Savior, the Lord of my life. I believe you died for me, and you rose again so I could live for you. Now fill me with your Holy Spirit so for the rest of my life I can live for you. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. Have a wonderful week. And, you know, let's get right. Let's not tolerate sin in our own lives, especially.